everyone. Happy afternoon, a very good afternoon. I hope and I believe all of you are doing well. Am I audible and visible? Hello everyone, am I audible and visible? There was some problem, I hope it should be resolved now. Yes. So, happy afternoon everyone. I hope and I believe all of you are doing well, and apologies for the delay. Today we are going to discuss the clinical MCQs mixed bag. So we had a quiz as well today, you know, so the good old days where we used to have daily quizzes, a pre-test and a post-test on a Telegram group in the form of quizzes, where you can take the quiz at your convenient timings. So how many of you gave the quiz and how many of you enjoyed the quiz? You would like to have more such quizzes? So maybe this is what we can do frequently. We can have a pre-session quiz and then we can discuss the questions in the session. Right. So I was so happy now just before starting the session, I thought let me just check how the quiz has been, and I wanted to share the leaderboard with you. And so I was very, very happy to see that 361 of you actually participated in the quiz in the short time of 3-4 hours when the quiz was live. That's a very, very good number and I'm happy to see. The overall accuracy of the quiz for all of you who participated has been 53%. Which could have been more, right? Which could have been more. So these are the the toppers on the leaderboard for the quiz. Out of 361 students, 5 students were the ones who got 100% accuracy. But you see, the score is different because in this quiz it is also based on how fast you answer. The faster you answer, the more points or more score you get. Yes. So congratulations, Mahi Reddy, for being the top one there. Then we have Kit Green, then we have Dilip, then we have Anit and Dr. Chatterjee. Yes. And yes, I'll send the PDF of the questions in the group after this session. I'll send the PDF. I also have to share the PDF of yesterday's FMG LMR series jo chal raha hai. So guys, I hope all of you are aware. Now, since FMG exam is on 18th, we are focusing on last minute revision for FMG exams. But needless to say that these sessions will be useful for NEET PG exam as well. So we are discussing the extremely important mixed bag topics from various subjects. Today, 5 p.m., it is going to be dedicated to radiology. So all the essential images, like we know, which do come in your exam, pneumothorax, pneumoperitoneum, hydropneumothorax, pleural effusion, I mean the must know ones, that is what we'll be quickly revising, like you would do one day before the exam, ki radiology mein kya kya images you should see one day before the exam. 10 p.m. This 5 p.m. will be on the Unacademy app, 10 p.m. will be on Unacademy YouTube channel, and then again tomorrow 5 p.m. and 10 p.m. So we have 4 more sessions in FMG last minute series, and apart from that, this series of a 12 p.m. will go on. Okay. Yes. New timetable, Abhi, so you guys can give a GT today. New timetable, I'll give you in a day or two, because as you can see, I'll be a bit busy with the FMG LMR as well. And I'm also working on the sessions that I've taken so far. honestly, as I've told you, I've taken so many sessions. So I want to segregate them all and give you a clear timetable, you know, which sessions you should be watching when. And I'll be also revising those sessions with you guys. So that would be a timetable for me as well. So give me some time. I don't want to make a timetable in a hurry. But maybe I'll take 2 more days to give you the timetable. Till that time, you guys can give a GT and review the GT questions and work on the topics that you have left from the other topics. So I'm giving you time to complete your unfinished topics from various subjects. So next 2 days, please do that. Okay. Yes, that exactly is what the plan, Dr. Saurabh. So we are going to have system-wise clinical vignettes, quizzes like this quiz. I'll be posting quizzes for that as well. Okay. Nahin. I hope the FMG exam does not get postponed. Yaar, at least ek exam to ho jaye si taki we get the, you know, faith ki chalo apna exam bhi ho jayega. Agar FMG bhi postponed ho gaya, to then pata nahi, fir to bada mushkil ho jayega. Haan. Next wale bachche I know are getting you know, ignored a lot, but neglect ho rahe hain. Those are going to appear for exam next year. Once I make this timetable, I'll be making the timetable for the students who will be appearing for next year as well. So then I'll be giving some focus and concentration to them as well. Do not worry about that. Right. So I'll be giving you guys, all those who have got the 15 days plus subscription and Academy Plus subscription free, I'll be giving you, that's what I'm working on, ki konse sessions, konse sequence mein you should be watching. I'll be giving you that. So I'll take some time for that. Give me 2 days. I'll be working on that. Ha. Chalo. So let's start with the first question here. We have total 7 questions that we had in the quiz today, right? So a 23-year college student was playing basketball when she directly fell on he. When he directly fell, maybe she or his, when he directly fell on his left elbow. He had sudden intense pain, unable to move the elbow, taken to emergency room, distress, holding the left elbow. On physical examination, pin prick sensation is absent in the left 5th digit and the medial aspect of the 4th digit, which is the most likely etiology. So we know that your medial 1.5 fingers, that is supplied by your ulnar, right? This is the ulnar nerve. Medially is the ulnar nerve. Aapka medial epicondyle fracture, cubital tunnel, that is your ulnar nerve. So this is a straightforward one, which is ulnar neuropathy. Okay, this is ulnar neuropathy. I am also going to show you ki kitne logo ne quiz mein isko right answer kiya. So look at this first question here. 78% have got this right. Okay, 78% have got this right. So 9% said median neuropathy. Now remember that median neuropathy is 3.5 fingers. But is the thinner eminence ka sensation gone in your median neuropathy? So yes, please remember, this is again important question, ki carpal tunnel mein jab median nerve jata hai, tab aapka thinar eminence nahi jata hai. It's the palmar cutaneous branch which goes above the flexor retinaculum. In your carpal tunnel, when your median nerve is affected, thinar eminence is spared, but your 3.5 fingers are gone. Axillary neuropathy. In which fracture do we see axillary neuropathy? Fracture surgical neck of humerus, right? Here you have the axillary nerve. You get regimental badge anesthesia, deltoid and teres minor paralysis. Ye sab humne kal dekha FMG series mein. You have anterior dislocation of shoulder, which can paralyze the axillary nerve. Axillary nerve comes from where? What part of the brachial plexus? Does it come from the roots, trunks or cords? If it comes from the cords, it comes from which cord? So, S. Paul and everyone who has a query regarding the quiz, I'll be sharing the link on the Telegram group. You can join the Telegram group, Dr. Nikita's Rad Synapse. Posterior cord, right? It comes from the posterior cord along with your radial nerve as well. Radial neuropathy, when do you have the radial nerve affected? When you have fracture shaft of humerus. Fracture shaft of humerus gives your radial neuropathy. What does your radial neuropathy cause? You have Dr. Kuma, the mnemonic wrist drop is seen with radial nerve. Drop is seen with radial nerve. So that will cause your wrist drop, difficulty in extension of the wrist. Musculocutaneous, it's a branch of lateral cord or brachial plexus, right? Lateral cord, you have LML, it supplies the flexor anterior compartment of the arm. And where will you get the sensation being affected? कहाँ का sensation loss होगा with the musculocutaneous nerve getting affected? What sensation will be affected? C5-6-7 is musculocutaneous nerve. C5-6 is axillary. Absolutely right. So your musculocutaneous nerve ends as your lateral cutaneous nerve of forearm. So it will be the lateral aspect of the forearm which will be affected. So there will be loss of sensation from the lateral forearm. It ends as your lateral cutaneous nerve of forearm, right? When you have musculocutaneous nerve paralysis, there will be problem in your elbow flexion. There will be problem in elbow flexion and supination or pronation. Biceps brachii, that is your supination, right? Median neuropathy, carpal tunnel syndrome mein jata hai. You will get your 3.5 fingers that will be affected for sensation. Thinner muscles will be affected, except which muscle will not be affected? Very important question again. Except adductor pollicis, because adductor pollicis is supplied by deep branch of ulnar nerve. It is supplied by deep branch of ulnar nerve. And ulnar neuropathy, it can be affected in your cubital tunnel, fracture of medial epicondyle of the humerus. It can be affected in your Guillain's canal. When do you get claw hand with your ulnar nerve? When do you get the claw hand? When it is more of the distal lesion, right? It's more of the distal lesion. You have ulnar paradox. So it's your ulnar paradox that we see. So all these are the important points. Your upper limb nerve injuries are extremely, extremely important. Okay. So this is what we see here. The medial 1.5 fingers, aage piche, that is your ulnar nerve. And you can get your claw hand as well, affecting the medial fingers. The medial fingers, because you will get paralysis of the first two lumbricals, and there'll be paralysis of interossei muscles as well. So you will get the claw hand, partial claw hand as well. Next question. ये question है जो कल मैंने पूछा था study with me session में रात के 1:30 बजे जब discuss कर रहे थे. Yes guys, so those who are new here, we do have study with me sessions as well late night. But I think it is having double effects on me. It is very, very productive. It's the time where I feel the most concentrated studying. So everyone watches me and they are also studying. But uske baad, you have that sense of satisfaction, achievement post that session. Phir uske baad neend hi nahi aati hai and I sleep very, very late. So my entire circadian rhythm is getting affected. Let's see what solution can we find to that. Yes, so yesterday we discussed this. 58-year-old man, shortness of breath for the last 2 years. He used to become breathless upon climbing 2 flights of stairs, but now after walking a couple of blocks, there is obesity. There's a loud pulmonic component of the second heart sound. Auscultation mein kuch nahi hai. Chest X-ray mein enlargement of the central pulmonary artery. Attenuation of the peripheral pulmonary vessels and oligemic lung fees. Which of the following is most likely to improve the shortness of breath? So all these are very, very important clues. Always remember, when you have loud pulmonic component, that means it is your pulmonary hypertension or it is your pulmonary embolism. Hypertension ki wajah se zor se aap jab darwaza band karoge, that will create more sound. So pulmonary hypertension will have a loud P2, will have a loud P2. Pulmonary hypertension S2, will it have narrow gap between the S2, A2 and P2, or it would be a wide gap? Will it be a narrow gap or will it be a wide gap? So because of the high pressures, the pulmonary valve is closing early. So that is why you get the narrow gap. So A2 and P2 will be closed. Okay. Now, second one, what do we need to know? Chest X-ray mein. Chest X-ray mein kya hoga? Chest X-ray mein, you have enlarged pulmonary artery. Do you guys remember what sign it is? When you get enlarged pulmonary artery, jug handle sign on chest X-ray. Jug handle sign, there is convexity of the pulmonary artery. The peripheral lung feels, you will see pruning. The branches are cut off. You don't see the vessels in the peripheral one third. There is pruning which is there. Oligemic lung feels. There's going to be right ventricular hypertrophy. All these are features of pulmonary hypertension. So please read the classification also. Okay, please read the classification also of pulmonary hypertension. The five groups WHO classification. Right. Now, the drugs that are used in pulmonary hypertension, out of all of this, it is your riociguat. Okay, that's your riociguat. As the term says, it is your cyclic guanylyl cyclase stimulator. It is the stimulator of guanylyl cyclase, soluble guanylyl cyclase receptor ka stimulator hai. And by guanylyl cyclase, we know that cyclic GMP will form, cyclic GMP, nitric oxide, vasodilatation, all these are important to reduce your pulmonary hypertension. Ranolazine is a drug used in ranolazine, it is your late sodium, Na sodium and La late. So remember, it acts on your late sodium current in the heart, the funny current, and it is used in angina. Okay, it is used in angina. Rivaroxaban, a recent hashtag entry session, antiplatelet drugs. Xaban, it is your factor 10A inhibitor. What is the antidote available? It is your Andexanet, right? It is your Andexanet alpha, which is iska antagonist. Then you have your Roflumilast. What is Roflumilast? Roflumilast is your phosphodiesterase 4 inhibitor. Ye yaad rakhna, FOR. It is your phosphodiesterase 4. ROF ko ulta padho, FOR. It is your phosphodiesterase 4 inhibitor used in COPDs, right? It is used in COPD. Then you have your rolapitant. Jaise aprepitant hota hai, waise rolapitant. That is your Where does your rolapitant act? It is used in post chemotherapy nausea and vomiting. Yes, that is your NK1 receptor antagonist. So that is your rolapitant, and it is used in your post chemotherapy nausea and vomiting. So when you get such questions, pharmac may try to decode the spelling of the drugs. The CIGUART helps you to identify cyclic guanylyl cyclase, that is cyclic GMP, vasodilator. Which are the other drugs used? So very, very important, all these drugs, you should be knowing the mechanism of action. Prostacyclins, that is your PGI2, that is your vasodilator. Okay, that's your vasodilator. So prostacyclin causes vasodilatation. It has antiproliferative. So you have epoprostenol, you have iloprost, and you have treprostinil. So you have epoprostenol, you have iloprost, and you have treprostinil. So all of these by prost and your prost, you can see that it's related to your prostaglandin, right? It's related to prostaglandin. So all these are your PGI2, okay, these are your PGI2s which cause vasodilatation. If they ask you which of the following PGI2 analog can be given as subcutaneous, parenteral, inhaled and oral as well, koi bhi route se de sakte hai, that is your treprostinil. Remember, treprostinil, tri routes, matlab teeno route se de sakte hai, oral B, inhaled B or parenteral B. While your iloprost is only inhaled, not IV, it is inhaled only. And epoprostenol is your parenteral, that is intravenous. Okay, that is intravenous. Then you have endothelin receptor antagonist, because endothelin proliferation karta hai, vasoconstriction karta hai. You have endothelin A, you have endothelin B, right? So endothelin A receptor is present on smooth muscle cell, while your endothelin B is present on the endothelium. So if this is the blood vessel, you have endothelium that has endothelin B. The smooth muscle inside, they have endothelin A receptor. Now, which are the drugs? Yesterday we were discussing late night. Which are your non-selective, that is both A and B, and which is a selective endothelin A receptor antagonist? So remember, bosentan and mesitentan, and you have emricentan. From all of this, you can see that entan, that is endothelin antagonist, the drugs ending in entan, endothelin antagonist. So you have bosentan, mesitentan and ambricentan. So ambri, starting with A, it is endothelin A receptor. Bosentan and mesitentan, it is both and mixed. You can remember with both and mixed, that is bosentan is both, mesitentan is mixed, that is they are non-selective, both A and B inhibitor. Okay, then you have phosphodiesterase 5 inhibitors. Phosphodiesterase, they break down your cyclic GMP, cyclic AMP, so uska inhibitor to increase the cyclic GMP levels. So you have sildenafil, you have tadalafil, which are your phosphodiesterase 5 inhibitors. This is the answer in the question. Soluble guanylate cyclase stimulator, that is RioC-GUAT. It is a soluble guanylate cyclase stimulator. It acts by directly stimulating your guanylate cyclase, as well as by sensitizing guanylate cyclase to endogenous nitric oxide. So it is also used in the treatment of chronic thromboembolic pulmonary hypertension, hypertension due to thromboembolism. Then you have another drug, which is Selexipag, prostacyclin agonist. Okay, prostacyclin agonist. One you had here were prostacyclins, which are basically your exogenous prostacyclins. This is a prostacyclin agonist. So you can see here I for prostacyclin, that is prostaglandin I, P for prostaglandin, AG for agonist. So this is your Selexipag, is your prostaglandin I agonist. Okay, it acts by activating the IP receptor, IP agonist, which is a subtype of prostacyclin receptor. So like prostacyclin, it will induce vasodilatation and inhibit your smooth muscle proliferation. So these are very, very important drugs. You all should know these drugs. These are extremely important. Okay, so उसमें क्या होता है, क्या क्या पढ़ना था हमको. यू हैव योर प्रोस्टासाइक्लिन्स, यू हैव योर प्रोस्टासाइक्लिन्स एंड यू हैव योर प्रोस्टासाइक्लिन एगोनिस्ट एंड यू हैव योर एंडोथेलिन एंटागोनिस्ट एंड यू हैव योर फॉस्फोडाइस्टरेज 5 इनहिबिटर्स एंड देयर इज योर सोल्युबल गुआनिलेट साइक्लेज स्टिम्युलेटर, राइट. Prostacyclins, EPO, ILO and treprostinil. Treprostinil given by all the three routes. ELO is by your inhalation route. EPO is IV. Prostacyclin agonist is your EPAG wala, right? Selexipag. Endothelin A and endothelin A and B. Ambricentan, this is both and mixed. Bosentan and mesitentan. This is your sildenafil and tadalafil. This one is your RioC-GUAT, cyclic guanylyl cyclase stimulator. Okay, now here very, very important pharmacology question. Your sildenafil should not be given with which drug? A patient who has history of angina, cardiac disorder, chest pain, wagera hai, nitrates ke saath kabhi nahi dena chahiye, because they can cause a lot of hypotension. Okay, they can cause a lot of hypotension together. So do not give them with nitrates. Okay, do not give them with nitrates, a very, very frequently asked question. So that was about drugs in pulmonary hypertension, right? Going to the next question now. Iske pehle, let's see how many of you got this right. Okay, so only 37% got this right. I hope now all of you will remember this riociguat, right? Which is your cyclic guanylyl cyclase stimulator. Okay, that's your riociguat. 37%, I'm sure next time will be 100% now. Many of you thought it is roflumilast as well. It is in your COPD asthma. It is phosphodiesterase 4 inhibitor. Okay. Let's go to the next question. What do we see in the next? 35-year-old emergency department. It is your 30 weeks of gestation, sharp abdominal pain. Her abdomen has not been enlarging as expected. Baby not moving as much compared to the previous one. Blood pressure is 90/60, pulse rate is 120, ultrasonography, no fetal movement, no heart motion, that means there is fetal demise, hemoglobin kam hai, platelet counts is less, bleeding time PT, PTT is more. What is the most appropriate next step in management? So, you know, when you get confused ki next step kya hona chahiye, put yourself into that situation like a clinician and think what you will be doing. Whatever is saving the patient's life, whether it's an investigation or it's the management part, that is the first thing that we should be doing. If your investigation is changing the management, then go for investigation. If even after doing the investigation, the management is going to remain the same, then the investigation will not be the next best step. Okay, so the next best step is basically the one which is saving the patient's life. All right, so this is basically your fetal demise. And you have blood pressure is low, bleeding time, PT, PTT, platelet count kam hai. All this indicates your IUFD induced DIC. This is since last 3 weeks the patient was having these complaints. Ki I'm not feeling the baby movements well. So after fetal demise, if the fetus is not removed within time, then it can lead to thromboplastin release. And that thromboplastin can activate the clotting system, and too much consumption of clotting factors that leads to your DIC, consumption coagulopathy. Okay, consumption coagulopathy. So this is your IUFD related DIC. Remember, IUFD can cause DIC in the mother. Disseminated intravascular coagulation. The thromboplastin is activating the clotting. Now, since there is hypotension, the first thing to do is get the blood pressure normal, that is IV fluids. After that, yes, the baby should be expelled out, but the most important step is stabilizing the patient. D-dimer-SI will help us in the diagnosis, but before that, important is giving your IV fluids. Fresh frozen plasma will be given in DIC. If there is continuous bleeding which is going on, then we will give fresh frozen plasma, we'll give cryoprecipitate. First stabilize the patient, right? First stabilize the patient. Yes, so after IV fluids, then we can go for D-dimer SI to confirm the diagnosis, and then we can do labor initiation and fresh frozen plasma if there is ongoing bleeding. Okay, fresh frozen plasma if there is ongoing bleeding. So remember, the first aim always has to be to stabilize the patient, stabilize the vitals of the patient. Has to be the first step in the patient management. So the answer here is your IV fluids. Okay, the answer here is IV fluids. And remember this most important point, that IUFD can lead to DIC in the mother. So remember that DIC can occur following IUFD. Thromboplastin release from the dead fetus triggers the clotting process within the mother, and DIC can occur. The first step is to stabilize the patient with fluid resuscitation. Let us see how many got this right. Okay, so it was only 31% who got this right, and many thought D-dimer SI. So again, remember, before investigation, if there is some life-saving management that you can do, first do that part and then do the investigation part. Okay, then do the investigation part. All right. Chalo, next question pe chalte hain. This is the next question. So let me show you how many of you got that question right. Question number 4. So only again 38% have got this right. The answer was 90%. There are mixed answers here. So guys, this was not a difficult question. Sensitivity pe question hai. Which option describes the sensitivity of the test? Just that the clinical scenario is long. So you have a scientist who's studying a new blood test with increased sensitivity specificity in detection of para influenza. Her best attempt at creating this test reached 82% and 88% specificity. So please do not mark the answer 82% is the sensitivity. Kyunki aapko itna direct question to puchhenge nahi. They are not testing your reading, right? She is hoping to increase this indices by at least 2% for each value. After several years, she believes that she has achieved a sensitivity and specificity that is greater than what she hoped for. She goes to South America to test the novel blood test and she finds 2,000 patients who are willing to participate in her study. Of the 2,000 patients, 1,200 of them are known to be infected with the virus. The scientist tests the blood of this 1,200 patients and only 120 of them tested negative. Of the following options, which is the sensitivity. अब आपको ये वाले part में से sensitivity पूछ रहे हैं. ये वाला sensitivity, of course, आपको नहीं पूछ रहे हैं. So you have to calculate the sensitivity. So guys, please watch that special class I've taken on sensitivity, specificity, decoded that. What? How do you calculate? What does that mean? Just to give you an overview. Okay, just to give you an overview. Sensitivity is all N there. And specificity is your P, right? Specificity has P. It does not have N in it. Sensitivity has N in it. It does not have P. So I remember it as sensitivity is inversely proportional to false negative. Specificity is inversely proportional to false positive. NN and PP. It is inversely. So if I write it as directly proportional, do iska ulta. False negative is true positive. Iska ulta, false positive is true negative. So sensitivity is basically true positive. We tend to get confused here as well. So remember, sensitivity is true positive and not true negative. Okay, it is true positive. What do you mean by true positive? True positive means these patients have tested positive by the test. And they also have the disease. That is true positive. How many people are here like that? Jinko disease bhi hai aur jo positive bhi huye. So you have 1200 patients who are known to be infected. So your positive cases basically who had the disease. Okay, the positive cases who had the disease was 1200. After that, only 120 of them tested negative. 120 tested negative. So how many tested positive? 1200 minus 120. That is 1080. So these are the diseased patients. Out of them, 1080 tested positive. So this is true positive. That means they had the disease and they tested positive also. So this is what is representing your sensitivity, which is true positive, which is true positive. So the sensitivity will be 1080 upon the total disease, that is 1200. So now if you cancel this, 12 9s are 108, so 90% answer aayega. Okay, the answer will be 90%. Let me show you this table here. Sensitivity is true positive upon true positive plus false negative. That means the total diseased patients. How many have the disease and test positive, that is true positive, upon the total diseased. In the denominator, you get total diseased. For specificity, what do you get in specificity? It is true negative. That means those who do not have the disease and those who test negative as well. So you have true negative upon all the non-diseased patients, all the non-diseased patients. That means false positive upon true negative. So this itself is one complete topic, one complete session that we need to have. I've already taken this on Unacademy's app, special class, free class hai. Session, zarur dekh lena. It will help you in clearing your doubts of PPV, NPV, sensitivity and specificity. Alright. So, ye iske detail mein main ja nahi rahi hun. I've told you the answer for this. Right, the answer for this is basically your 90%, 1080 upon 1200, because this is your true positive upon all the diseased patients. True positive upon all diseased. All right. Next one. Let us go to the next one. I'm sorry, I forgot to put this image in the quiz today. So this is the image that we have here. What does the peripheral smear show? What are we seeing in the peripheral smear? These are all spherocytes, right? There are spherocytes with absence of central pallor. So all these are spherocytes. Now, when you see spherocytes, two things that I want you to always think of. Either it can be hereditary spherocytosis or it can be. Either it can be hereditary spherocytosis or what can it be? Spherocytes are also seen in your immune hemolytic anemia. Okay, they are also seen in immune hemolytic anemia. The test which helps to differentiate for immune hemolytic anemia, we do your Coombs test. So this will be Coombs test positive, immune wala. This will be Coombs test negative. So this is how we differentiate. So when they give you spherocytes with Coombs test positive, it is immune hemolytic anemia. Spherocytes without Coombs test positive, that is your hereditary spherocytosis. Okay. So what do we have here is 37-year-old, otherwise healthy man, CBC, hemoglobin thoda kam hai, MCV 82 hai, not very less. Reticulocyte count is 3.2, WBC is normal, platelet count is there. Physical examination, spleen is just palpable, and you are given that a direct antiglobulin test is negative. That means your Coombs test is negative. Which of the following best describes the etiology? So you have spherocytes with Coombs test negative, hereditary spherocytosis, which is a problem in the membrane. Okay, it's an inherited membrane abnormality. Spectrin, enchirin, all of those are affected. Majority cases are autosomal dominant, right? So that's an inherited membrane abnormality. If it would have been bone marrow hypocellularity, which is basically seen in your aplastic anemia, right? Aplastic anemia is a cause that we would be thinking of. In that case, your reticulocyte count will be less than 3. Reticulocytes will also be less because bone marrow is hypocellular. If you have microangiopathic process, that means the red blood cells are getting clotted, break ho rahe hain, chote chote vessels mein, like you have TTP and all, in that case you will see broken RBCs. Broken is your schistocytes, so we'll be seeing schistocytes, which are not seen here. Immune mediated hemolysis will have spherocytes, but it will have your Coombs test positive, antiglobulin test positive. Oxidant hemolysis, kal dekha tha FMG LMR mein, that is your G6PD deficiency. That shows your bite cells, that is degmacytes. That shows your bite cells, degmacytes, which are not seen here. Okay, which are not seen here. So that is why the answer is this. Please remember these points. Hypocellularity, aplastic anemia, reticulocyte count will be less than 3. Your schistocytes will be present in microangiopathic process. Immune mediated will have antiglobulin test positive. Oxidant is your G6PD deficiency, and you will have bite cells positive. So I don't know how you got, some students might have got this right as well, and 37% actually got it right even when the image was not given. Exam mein kabhi aise hota hai aur aapko diya hai ki direct antiglobulin test is negative, think of spherocytes se related hai kuch, because that is the point when in hematology they give you specifically that your antiglobulin test is negative. ठीक है? Osmotic fragility क्या होती है spherocytosis में? What happens to osmotic fragility in hereditary spherocytosis? prolonged, what it is? Osmotic fragility increases or decreases? Osmotic fragility increases. Osmotic fragility increases. While in thalassemia, what happens in thalassemia to your osmotic fragility? In thalassemia, osmotic fragility decreases. What is the test that we do for showing the osmotic fragility based? Your Nesterov test, right? Your Nesterov test is done. Naked eye, single tube, red cell, osmotic fragility test. So your osmotic fragility decreases in your thalassemia. Okay, Nesterov test karte hain. Chale, next question pe. Let us go to the next question, guys. Remember this flow chart. If you have MCV less than 80, think of microcytic. If it is 80 to 100, normocytic. More than 100 is macrocytic. If your reticulocyte count is more than 3, it is hyperproliferative, hemolysis wala wagera. If it is less than 3, it is hypoproliferative, bone marrow problem like aplastic anemia. Alright, so that is about this question. Very, very important concept to be understood. Next one. Again, this is a very good conceptual question here. So you have the options here: iron deficiency, beta thal, alpha thal, folate, or pure red cell aplasia. What do we see here? You have hemoglobin 10.8, which is less. RBCs 5.7. MCV 76, less than 80. Just now we said it is microcytic wala. So this is less than 80. So this is your microcytic anemia. RDW is 12.4, which is normal. When you are given RDW, which is normal, what do you start thinking of? You start ruling out your, what do you start ruling out? Your iron deficiency anemia. When you have RDW normal, you start thinking of thalassemia. Okay, start thinking of thalassemia. So they tell you that she started on ferrous gluconate and 5 weeks later she shows no improvement. Ideally, if there is iron deficiency with iron supplementation, within 4 weeks there should be improvement in hemoglobin. Also then hemoglobin electrophoresis is normal. So now you were thinking of thalassemia, electrophoresis is normal. So then you can start thinking of alpha thalassemia, where your RDW will be normal and electrophoresis can also be normal. Beta thalassemia will have abnormal electrophoresis. You will have increase in HbF, HbA2 bad jayega. Iron deficiency anemia, RDW will be high. There will be response to iron treatment. Folate deficiency, it is your macrocytic. MCV more than 100, here it is 76. Pure red cell aplasia, it is your normocytic anemia, seen with parvovirus, maybe your hepatitis infection as well, or aapka SLE wagera mein dikh sakta hai. Which tumor you have associated red cell aplasia? With which tumor do we have red cell aplasia is associated with which tumor? Red cell aplasia, remember, is associated with thymoma. Okay, it is associated with thymoma. So thymoma, myasthenia gravis, red cell aplasia can be associated. So is everyone clear here why the answer is alpha thal? Because RDW is normal, it is microcytic anemia, and your electrophoresis is also normal. In beta thalassemia, your electrophoresis is abnormal. Alright, so these are the points that I've highlighted. Increased RDW, you get electrophoresis abnormal. Here you get electrophoresis can be normal, RDW is normal. This is megaloblastic, this is normocytic, parvo, thymoma and SLE associated. Alright. Next, I think this is the last question. Ye wala question dekhte hain kitne logo ka right aaya tha. So, only 12% got this right. So, I think this is the toughest question that everyone thought on. So the point to be remembered, alpha thalassemia trait can have hemoglobin electrophoresis which is normal. It can have a normal hemoglobin electrophoresis. All right. Next question. I think this was an easy one. So 48-year-old man, productive calf, dyspnea on exertion, 6 saal se symptoms hai, allergic rhinitis bhi hai, there is no weight loss, night sweat, hemoptysis, smoking ka history hai, and BMI is very high, auscultation pe wheezes hai, spirometry mein FEV1 is 59% which is decreased. Whenever you see the point of FEV1 decreased, first thing that should come to your mind is, yes, there is some obstructive lung disease. Okay, there's your obstructive lung disease. He is on lisinopril for hypertension. Which of the following interventions would be most useful to slow the progression of this patient? So here, because it is FEV1 decreased, it is your obstructive lung pathology. There's history of smoking. So the best intervention to stop the progression is your smoking cessation is the best measure. It is the smoking cessation. Your lisinopril, AC inhibitors do cause dry cough, but they do not cause your obstructive lung disease. Increasing physical activity, weight reduction, all of these will help. But the most important is your smoking cessation. Look at the graph here. Okay, look at the graph here. This is your age and this is the FEV1. So look at the graph. Someone who has never smoked, look at the FEV1. It stays very good throughout the life. Okay, the FEV1 stays high. Someone who smoked but stopped at 45 and someone who stopped at 65. So you have blue color here and you have the light blue color here. So uska FEV1 of course will be less. It jitna late stop karoge utna FEV1 will be poor. So this person stopped at 45, this person stopped at 65. And someone who smoked regularly, this is the graph. You have rapid decline in your FEV1. Someone who's smoking regularly, there's a rapid decline as compared to the rest of the people. That is your smoking regularly people. Okay. So the best intervention, even if you stop, then you can have better results. The earlier you stop, the better are the results. So the most important intervention is your smoking cessation. Okay. That's your smoking cessation. How many got this right is 59%. Okay, so 59% got this right. Okay? Alright. So, let us quickly see this, guys. So, all of you who appeared for the quiz, remember that you will be able to access these questions for revision as well. You also have this option of like this flashcards karke option aayega. That's the best way to revise, I feel. Let me show you the flashcards here. Okay, so let us quickly revise whatever we learned. Let me look. As quiz start ho gaya, ek minute. Am I audible and visible, guys? So the first one that we saw here, alright, the first one that we saw here where you have the loss of sensation in the left fifth digit, right, there's a loss of sensation in the left fifth digit. And the medial aspect, the answer is going to be your, what is the answer going to be in that case? The answer is going to be ulnar neuropathy. So this is how you can keep revising. Okay, let's go to the next one. This is the next one that we saw. What was it? Was your enlargement of central pulmonary artery, pulmonary hypertension, and the drug was asked. That was your riociguat, right? That was riociguat. The answer was riociguat. Next one which we had, your 30 weeks gestation female and blood pressure was low, bleeding time everything was high, DIC was the diagnosis. First stabilized because the blood pressure is low, So IV fluids was the treatment, right? IV fluids was the treatment. Then you had sensitivity per question. 1200 infected, you have 120 negative, 1080 positive. So sensitivity is 90%, right? Sensitivity is 90%. Next one. So this was a question where we had your direct antiglobulin test negative, image of spherocytes was given, reticulocyte count was high. That was your hereditary spherocytosis, membrane abnormality, right? That was membrane abnormality. Next, we had your, so we have your RDW, which is normal, MCV less than 80 microcytic, did not improve with iron, electrophoresis is normal, microcytic, RDW normal. So whenever you get your microcytic anemia with RDW which is normal, with electrophoresis which is normal, think of your alpha thalassemia trait. Okay, think of your alpha thalassemia trait. Alright, so the answer was alpha thalassemia. Next one, what was the last one? So you have your COPD patient which has FEV1, right? The FEV1 of 59%, FEV1 decreased. Best measure is to stop the smoking, right? So smoking cessation is the best method. All right, so that was about the today's session, guys. I hope all of you have enjoyed the session and the quiz particularly. Do let me know your feedbacks on that. We can have, you know, the sessions based on this, a quiz before the session. Maybe we can have system wise quizzes, we can have subject wise quizzes, and then we will discuss the questions in the session. Alright, okay, so ye ho gaya hamara complete. Thank you so much for joining in. How to access the quiz, for all those who are asking for how to access the quiz, I'll be sharing the links on the Telegram group, and you can, the Telegram group name is Dr. Nikita's Rad Synapse. Okay, the Telegram group is Dr. Nikita's Rad Synapse. You can join there and you'll get the quiz links there. Okay. Yes. And please remember, we are meeting today at 5 p.m. and 10 p.m. 5 p.m. on the Unacademy app. If you're joining for the first time, the code to join is Dr. Nikita. And we'll be discussing radiology images. Very, very important for your exam. And 10 p.m. it's gonna be your mixed bag last minute revision like we had yesterday, important topics that we'll be discussing. Maybe predominantly it will be rapid pharmacology revision that we can do. That will be the target today. Okay, so I see a lot of, you know, positive feedback for the quiz, so maybe we'll continue this and see how it goes. I'll be sharing the quiz link again tomorrow morning as well for the tomorrow's 12 p.m. session. All right, so thank you so much everyone. And goodbye, take care, keep studying, keep revising and keep winning. See you at 5 p.m. on the Unacademy app. Thank you.